stand next to once, and so I know him that he's a little bit more bark than bite, although he has bitten, hasn't he?
I would say it's a nip.
More of a nip. And so, so I felt comfortable grabbing the leash because I know him a little bit, but I know Buddy. Hey, sorry. I'm gonna grab that, sir.
Yeah.
Hey, Sawyer. But yeah, so a lot of dogs like this. They're a little bit more bark than bite.
Mm-hmm.
If we can kind of give the leash to the next guy, he's like, oh, I'm with you now. Mm-hmm. And so I can kind of calm him down a little bit to where, there we go. See, now you're with me, buddy. Huh. So remind me, when is he kind of nipped? What was the context?
When he nips?
Yeah.
Okay, so the couple contexts and things I wanted to talk about. What is it when he sees other people or dogs?
Like on a walk?
On the walk.
Yeah.
They come to our house.
Oh. You just want to bark at somebody, don't you?
And sorry.
No, I can hear you.
Okay, so he might nip. He's doing fine, and then suddenly he gets in this hyper mode where he wants to run around.
Gotcha,
like he's hurting you.
Yeah.
And at that point he'll nip down the ear. So that's the other sort of this behavior, that's another kind of, I'm guessing it's some sort of hurting behavior.
Gotcha. Yeah. A lot of these are big time micromanagers. They want to manage everything around.
But it happens often. Excited, like I did an experiment. So I took him on a trail just after where I thought nobody.
Uh-huh.
And I let him leash. I wanted to go beating him off leash. He was really good. He'd run off. When you called, he'd stick around you. He was really well behaved off leash.
Mm-hmm.
Except he liked to play with grab sticks out of the ground and peel off the mouth. And then he'd get, at one point he got really hyper.
Yeah.
And then coming up and jumping at me in
gotcha.
Living circles. So he just gets in these. I've taken him running a couple of times when he'll do fine running, and then mm-hmm. suddenly he'll snap into.
So yeah, what you're referring to is like when the dog's just running a little bit, he starts making bad choices.
Yes.
Now adrenaline can lead to chasing attention. It can lead to a lot of things. Adrenaline often leads to like behavior problems.
Yeah.
And so what we need to teach him how to self-regulate. Easy. Yeah, you're especially loud today, my friend. So now the enemy of adrenaline is focus. And so like what you're talking about, that's what you're losing. Like somebody comes to your house and all focus is gone. He's like, focus is on that guy coming through the door.
That's exactly
or on that person.
Very obedient, but when those things happen, it's his.
Yeah, when focus is
he will not obey anything, then he just goes off.
Gotcha, okay. Yeah, so what we're gonna focus on is focus. You're just loud today. You weren't this loud last time I met you. Huh? You're just on one. And so we're gonna focus a lot on focus. We start to see the dog calm.
Mm-hmm.
Because this is just the product of a dog who doesn't know where the focus should go. It goes over here and it makes me nervous about that, and it goes over here and it makes me nervous about that. And whenever I scream, things work out fine. Because if he's on a walk and he screams at that person probably doesn't touch him. And so he's like, it worked, you know? Or that dog goes by and he screams at it, and the people keep walking by, he's like, oh, this works. And so, hey buddy, it's very self fulfilling when he's like, I just gotta scream and it works and it keeps working.
Yeah, the interesting thing is when we picked him up, when we got him at the show, when I went and met him, I took him off the shelter, he passed other dogs, just perfect. We got him home, there was only a couple of days manifest.
And that's not uncommon. A lot of dogs in the shelter environment, there's so much stuff going on that they're proof that they can't really know who they are. Who he is, he's just insecure. So there's a lot of work. This is nothing that we haven't helped and fixed before. So,
okay guys, so at this point with Sawyer, what we're gonna try to do, I just want him to like bond with me a little bit because I'm about to put a different prong collar on him and an E collar, so I need him to kind of get used to me moving around, being near him and the way that I move, and we need him to not be threatened by that. So I'm just letting him be sensitized to the way that I do things right now. As we do this, I just need him to stand here, touch him a little bit, give him space, just so he realizes that I'm not that concerned about him, and that fixated. Like, too much fixation on this state of mind will make him weirded out and make him a little more dangerous. So you just take this a little bit slow right now, getting ready to get him collared up. So for a dog with this coat, I typically like to do the long points on the e-collar, or the longer. There you can get longer ones than this, but you have a special order. So Sawyer came in with kind of a Petco special collar. I like to go with the Herm Springer ones because they're a little bit lighter, a little bit less clunky, and they have rounded tips on them. Typically a dog this size, I like to take out about three lengths. Three lengths?
I say three, but you might even do four. I'll bet you his neck is smaller than you think.
So he's a little bit weird about putting on the collars right now, so I'm not gonna do it while he's tied up right here. I'm gonna go into the other room and kind of get him moving around because he's feeling a little bit trapped being tied up. So as I work with him for a minute, that's gonna be part of my first session, is to get a collar on him. All right guys, so we got Sawyer into the training room right now. Now it's not always advisable, but my gut tells me I can do it. I'm gonna sit down with him. And so the reason I don't generally recommend that people do this is because you're putting your face down by a dog. So if you have a reactive dog, it's not a good idea to put your money maker down there. So keep your face away from him. So I want to do this without like making eye contact or being too weird about it. So I'm not going to just like go right at him with a collar and really pressure him in that way. Just going to kind of take it easy. So that was loose enough. I do want to take another link out. So when I feel like it's important not to have your hands too close to his mouth as he's fixating, but I know what's out there. So if he got too hyped up right now, what could happen is he's fixating on a dog right there and I'm touching him and he gets frustrated and bites my hand. So these little stock dogs can redirect really, really quickly. So I'm gonna take the leash off the other collar and put it on this one. The pinch on him, just giving him a little bit longer. And this is part of the process, and it's probably a little boring to watch, but I don't want to rush it just for the sake of entertainment. So we'll just take it slow. this point, like, he's kind of processing, okay, he pulled out another collar, like, I'm facing him, that made him a little bit uncomfortable, so it's subtle, but he's asking for a little bit of space right now, and so I'm going to give it to him, and then in a second, he's going to come back up to me and want to get some affection. So when he does that, I'll give him a little bit, and then I'll put the collar on him, and then we'll kind of get started a little more from there. So when we're doing affection, I'll do it for a minute, and that was quite a bit of a touch there. So what I'm seeing is that he's relaxing a whole lot, but what I know of this dog is that he'll relax, and then if he gets training pressure, he'll redirect onto you. So it's an art at this point, just helping him be comfortable, but limiting the decisions that we're allowing him to make. So next step is I want to find the working level on the e-collar. So we've done this in videos before, but what I want to do is I want to start at zero, work up 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 till we get to a level. Now, there are some dogs we get in there that have higher working level than others. Typically, a dog this reactive is going to be very, very low on the e-collar. So we want to be aware, you don't want to just turn it to 15 and get cranking with a dog like this, because his working level may be 4, maybe 3 or 4 or something low like that. To find it, what I'm going to do, I'm going to start on one, on the e-collar, just going to give it a little tap. So I don't want to, like, look at him intensely as I'm doing this. Just going to give it a little tap and see if I see anything from him. I'm looking for an ear twitch, I'm looking for him to feel it and, like, pay attention to it. There's a tap on 2. There's 3. There's 4. There's 5 right there. The 5, it may be stimulation from outside of the room, but I almost feel like I see it. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go to 6, see if I see any reaction. All right, so I don't think I'm seeing anything yet. So I've worked up to 8 right now. He still is not feeling it. Sometimes when you're doing this with a dog, you'll get up to 8 or 10 or 12 or 14, and then you'll find that their working level is actually a little bit lower because their brain doesn't know how to process this certain type of e-collar stimulation. So we plan, I always plan to find an upper level where they begin to know what it is, and then plan to take it down a little bit. All right, so on 10, I feel like I see a good enough ear twitch that I'm gonna call that his working level for this point. Again, we don't need to see too many big things happening. I just want to see him, like, hey, I feel some stimulation there. I want to know how to turn it off. Now, we're just going to do some pressure release with the leash. When I handle a dog like this, I want to handle the leash in a way that if he tries to bite me, I can protect it. So if you have too much leash, if you give the dog this much leash and they decide to come at you, you're kind of in trouble and they'll get a leg bite on you. So you want to be close enough to him, come on, that you can protect yourself. He'll, now, good boy. Now we're not going for a lock here. All I need is for him to pay attention to me, him to resolve the pressure well, and then release when I ask him to. Now at this point, what I can see is that the loose end of the leash here is gonna cause me a little bit of trouble, so I'm gonna go with a 3-foot lead. Just to make things a little more simple and a little less clunky. Come on. Good boy. Good boy. Kill. Wait. Good. Good boy. Kill. Good. Good. Kill. Good. Good boy.
sit.
Good boy. So what I'm doing now is I'm throwing in some obedience commands, kind of falling back on some vocabulary he knows, because this focus exercise might be really foreign to him. So I want to do that and make him feel a little bit more comfortable, because I don't know what it looks like on camera, but I see some subtleties that tell me he might start nipping at my leg to control this a little more. Heel. Good. Good job. Heel. Good. Heel. Good. Good boy. Good. Good boy. Heel. Yay. Good boy.
Right there.
Here, sit.
Good.
Good boy. Heel. Good. 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 Good boy. Good boy.
Good job.
Heel. Heel. Good. Good. Right there. Sit. Good. Good job. All right, I'm gonna introduce the place command. Place. Good.
Okay.
Now, I just want him to get comfortable with this surface first of all. So in a first session, it can be a little bit of a push sometimes to get a place command, but I think he can handle it. So we're just gonna do the same thing over. So your place. Good. Good job.
Okay.
Okay. Good. Good boy. Good job. So your place. Good. Good job. All right, so when we do a stay with the dog, we increase duration, distance, and distraction in which they hold that stay. So, ooh, place. So I'm holding down eight collar, place, and let up. Good boy. Now, if you notice, the e-collar takes a lot of conflict out of it, because if I were to pull him back out there with a leash, I definitely could have got some reactivity. Where I did that with the e-collar, he was just like, he just went up there to resolve the stimulation. So I introduced stimulation through the healing, now I'm introducing it through the place command. Now when I get eye contact, okay, we let him off. So what we want to do is teach him that eye contact is a good thing from people. So your place, yay, good boy. Good job, buddy. Good boy. Okay, good. And that's about all I need to accomplish with this dog in this session. So we'll take him a little further the next time we get him out. Hi guys, all right, so we're here with Sawyer. Now, basically up to this point, we've been building vocabulary, building relationship, getting used to our touch, like trying to get us to where we feel safe with him. Everything's going really well. He's at the point in his training where I want to start transferring him to off-leash. I like to use a long line for that. So when I get him out, I'm just gonna kind of go over, excuse me, all of his words, all of his commands, and make sure he's doing them.
You're getting emotional about this, aren't you?
I am. I always tear up this year.
Sure, I'm with border collie. I'm gonna keep the attention on me for a second so Joe can talk his way out of this.
Good boy. All right, so we're starting using the long line just like we would a leash.
Cool.
And then what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna give him more and more of this leash. So I'm gonna turn away, heel. And he's on five.
So the way that we often like to explain it is that the e-collar is like a language, right? And so the e-collar is just this training tool. It's not this zap tool of like, all right, the dog's being bad, let's zap him. It's this communication tool. So if you go back and rewind like 30 seconds, you'll see, you know, we're trying to communicate him the concept of how to heal tightly. You know, how to stay nice and close. Now this is important because, you know, a dog that has the reactivity that he has needs to heal tightly, because if he's off, you know, wandering and sniffing, his mind's gonna be wandering, and it's much easier for him to get aggressive on the walk. And so we want him to heal tightly, right? So we have that as a given. Now, we don't always wanna have to rely on the leash, because we want this dog to be able to be off leash on a trail and things like that. So that's where the e-collar communication comes in. So if you look at, you know, that right there, or rewind about a minute, you know, as Joe was turning, in the beginning stages of teaching, we probably would have used, you know, the leash to teach him to stay close. But we're transferring him to being off leash. And so in doing that, Joe's using the e-collar in a little bit, you know, on a very low level, and a little bit more like body language. So he turned, the dog didn't turn with him, so he used a little bit of continuous stimulation, patted his leg a little bit, the dog got back in position, and that little tickle shut off. And so the dog starts to realize, oh, okay, you know, even if the leash isn't telling me where to go, that little tickle means get back. And, you know, it means get to his side or what have you. So sorry to take over the talk, man. Just
no, I appreciate that. I think I have that French fry swallowed, so.
Yep. Yeah, so this is a bigger part of the process on when we start transitioning a dog to being off leash, we start using more body language than we did before. And then as time goes on, we break that down too, because we don't want to have to always use a ton of body language. We want the dog to be able to just simply pay attention to the words that we're saying and things like that.
Exactly.
So yeah.
So, and we're using three different things to like create urgency for the dogs to obey commands. So e-collar is one, my voice the other, and then body language is the other one. So if we use them three things really well for the next little while, once these behavioral patterns are set in a little better, then we can drop the e-collar, because obviously we want to get away from anything that's not part of what you carry with you automatically every day. So when we're training, we do like to go away from the e-collar eventually. And if we communicate really well, that happens. The more consistent we are, the better we communicate, the more quickly that happens.
Yeah, because eventually, you know, with everything, it doesn't matter what type of training you're doing. If you're using treats and clickers, you want to get to a point where you're not using treats and clickers. If you're using leashes and e-collar or body language or whistles or whatever you're using, you don't have to listen. You can get one whistle forever, but you know, we want to get to the point where it's more about, you know, communicating that the dog understands the concept that it's just muscle memory.
This is what I call modulating pressure. If I want a dog to look at me and I can tell they're just not quite sure what's going on, I'll move towards them,
okay,
and then I move away and I'll do that back and forth until they become kind of at ease, or else they get curious about what you're doing. You go forward and back.
Modulating pressure?
Modulating pressure.
That sounds like a NASA. You know, NASA type
trademark.
You have? So describe what that means for you, modulating pressure.
So I'll show you. Come here, buddy, please. Now, good job. So if you ask a dog to do something that it wouldn't have done on its own, like just the act of that, you're creating a little bit of stress. By creating a little bit of stress, in certain dog minds, the fallout of that could be avoidance. Place. So right there, place. Good job, buddy. So the byproduct of that is gonna be avoidance. Now, what we want to do is we want to teach them to work past avoidance. So when you go past avoidance, you'll look at somebody and become engaged. And that's what we do, because if we wait for this to happen on its own, he learns that, wow, once I engage this human, good things happen for me. So it's all about creating a state of mind in the dog where they're like, hey, look at me. I want to do something for you. Pay attention to me. Not, I'm avoidant and I just want to get out of here. So I'm gonna modulate pressure. Okay, so by just me going away from him that time, he looked up at me and I wanted to capture that moment. Good job, buddy. Good,
so what does the word modulate even mean?
I assume. But it means...
I just called you on something. Yeah, on accident.
So I think it means to like put on pressure and then take off. And there's gonna be a lot of mad clients because I've been saying this for at least like 4 months now.
I haven't heard you say this word, modulate pressure. I like it though.
So I'll look it up on Wikipedia.
But like I say, I feel like, you know, like in that Matt Damon movie, The Martian.
Yeah.
Like, oh my gosh, the outer door just blew. We have to modulate pressure. You know,
probably the exact same.
I feel like it would be a NASA term.
Okay, so I'm gonna put it on. So he's kind of looking at me, but just for the sake of showing the camera, I'm gonna do it a couple times. So he's looking away. I'm gonna go in. You can see, like, by his body language, he's like, what's this human doing to me? He's standing over me. And then I go off. And then I go in. Okay,
good.
So you can see his head actually kind of comes up. So he gets more and more engaged.
So you're adding pressure.
And then taking it away.
And then taking it away as he gives you even like a little bit.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, like a sine wave. Modulator.
A sine wave? You are from NASA. I don't understand any of this.
So hopefully that's helpful to you guys. Modulate pressure if you can't get your dog to look at you.
I flunked out of geography. I don't understand sine waves.
That is calculus. Calc 2 and 3.
Not geography? I'm just teasing. It's all
there's many like earthquakes. There's sine waves.
There we go.
All right. Thank you, guys.
All right. So we're heading over. We're at the stage with this guy where we want to start practicing our step back recall. Now, if you're not familiar with our step back recall, I encourage you to watch some of our other case study videos. What it is, it's the process. It's this technique that we've developed where we teach the dog that when you're starting to elevate, we often call it like the aggression snowball, right? You know, the dog starts getting antsy and anxious and it turns into barking. So before it ever gets to that point of him barking and lunging, this is the process that we use to kind of correct that.
The diagram germ actually, there's a different model that you can do without writing.
What?
It involves children's children.
Now you're making stuff up. Let's go to the city of Alaska.
Google it.
That's measuring triangle?
That's, I don't remember exactly. I don't remember those words. You're calling, right? Here.
Good.
All right. So at this point in the training, what I want to do, I'm just going to start reading him. So I'm not going to be really particular about obedience because I want to give him enough reins to kind of get involved in his surroundings, which means, and so this is what naturally happens when people take their dogs in public to interact. They kind of give them a little bit too much leash and just kind of hope for the best. Typically when we're training dogs, we want to manage the environment well. And make sure that we're controlling it. So we're not doing a lot of hoping, we're doing a lot of demanding. But at this point, I want to get him to feel a little bit of freedom, to feel a little bit of decision-making ability, and we're going to recall him away from that.
Because if you remember, 2 weeks ago or whenever when he started, he would be barking at everybody right now. He was losing his mind at every single person that he saw. And even, you know, with that person coming out and being boisterous, he just showed interest.
Good.
There he was starting to show a little bit of interest, so Joe just kind of calls him back just to kind of remind him, hey, pay attention to me.
Boy.
Now that interest might have led to nothing or it might have led to something. Right now, at this stage in the training, we want to err on the side of caution and say, okay, well, we always do, but you know, we want to err on the side of caution and say, okay, you might be thinking negative thoughts, so let's get the attention back on me.
Good boy.
Yeah, this is something that internally, you know, Joe and I talk a lot about. The step back recall is such a powerful method, and it's one that, like, when everything lines up, we often have to do it like once or twice. And so, like, getting it on camera, it's tough because, like, you know, it happens organically. We're pulling a dog out of the crate, he starts to act up, we do the step back recall, and soon it gets to the point where he realizes, oh, I'm not allowed to act up. And so you can tell that he's a little bit nervous here, and that's fine, because like I say, his life was nervousness before, his life was anxiety, and any person he saw, he wanted to, you know, kind of act foolish about. And so now his stress level is way less. I mean, it's still there, but with repetition, that's how we get rid of that. You know, the more he comes and does stuff like this, or, you know, when he goes home and the owners take him to Home Depot and to the pet store and to the vet's office and to the park, and, you know, he's now around people in a structured way, the more, you know, we often talk about socialization is not exposure. Socialization is controlled exposure. And that's exactly what we're doing here. So like I said, a week and a half, 2 weeks ago, he's firing up on everyone. Now he's not firing up on anybody, but what's replaced it, like I say, is a touch of anxiety. Well, not even replaced it, but you know, what we're seeing is a touch of anxiety, but repetition will help us get away from that. He sees the dog, and they respond as well.
And you'll notice, and this is just tiny little things I like to point out to our clients, is you notice how Joe handles him. Like, Joe kind of claims some space there, right? And so here comes somebody with a dog. Joe sees that he's interested but not making bad choices. And without making a big deal about it, just kind of steps in between the two and kind of just claims that space. And, you know, there's no command, there's no correction, there's no reprimand, there's no anything. It's just a reminder of like, oh yeah, just remember about me. And little handling things like that are so important as you learn to kind of work on a dog that, you know, you're rehabbing for aggression.
I feel like there's kind of an art to knowing when to let them process that as a non-threat and when to redirect, because at some point, we're not going to be doing redirection every time they get stimulated. We're going to let them go through a little bit of stress, recover on their own, and that's how they gain coping skills. They get better and better coping skills the more you do this with them.
T.I. is in that movie.
Now, who's T.I.? I've heard of T.I., but like, I can't place him. What does he sing?
So...
Wait, you got T.I. on your phone?
Well, I can just ask Google to play it and it'll play it.
Ooh, Google's really accommodating. But then Google will kick it off of YouTube.
That's true. Jerks.
So...
So T.I.'s he's a rapper. I don't really, like, I don't know what the songs are called, but...
And so he's in the
he's in the movie. And he doesn't have a very big role. He's the partner. They're cops.
Oh, so he's not like the bad gangster guy that he's fighting against and kidnapping and stuff?
No. He used to be in the trailer park and then like got really big growing drugs or selling drugs.
You gotta hit your roof whenever you go in the yellow light.
Is that a thing?
Yeah. Otherwise.
Otherwise what?
I don't know, something bad happens, right?
Bad luck?
Yeah.
I don't believe in luck.
Well, that sounds like a Vin Diesel quote. I don't believe in luck. Real men make their own luck.
Work hard. Strong muscles. Okay, we'll go in the front entrance.
Alright.
He's looking good. I think he can do really well.
Yeah, so we're kind of finishing up our transformation here. And if you remember, this little guy was barking like crazy at Air Buddy. And so we're going to, you know, as we finish up, we want to take him out in public and see how he does with like complete strangers. So, all right. So one thing we like to do, this is just good practice, that if you've got a dog that's been struggling with aggression or reactivity, before taking them to something that we worry might be stressful, do a little bit of obedience. You know, get him moving, get him thinking about you. We call it priming the pump. And essentially what priming the pump does is it gets the dog's mind focused and thinking about you. Because dogs don't have very good multitasking. So if they're thinking about you, it doesn't leave a lot of room to be thinking about stuff that used to make him super stressed.
Good. Good boy. Come on.
And so oftentimes priming the pump is just 2 or 3 minutes of like quick little obedience out in the parking lot. So this is before you go in the vet, before you go in the pet store, before you go on a trail, before you take him into wherever you're taking him, get his mind active.
Do it in the driveway before going on a walk in your neighborhood.
Yeah, actually, yeah, I don't talk about that enough, but that's one thing that, you know, we've got some clients that live in apartment buildings. I say, hey, you know, do it inside your apartment, go out in the hallway and do it in the hallway, and then, you know, go on your walk or in the driveway. You know, if you've got a reactive dog, do it in the driveway. Because once you get in a rhythm, the dog's going to be focusing on you, but not as much as right now. So we want to really, like, set his mind in focus mode.
I think we're ready.
Should we head in?
That's my
favorite. It's unfortunate.
Yeah. Good. I like to put them in the down, like right when we get in. So they can kind of, they're not like pulling me and I can get them to check back in. Okay, good boy.
So dogs like this needs a lot of communication, right? because before, the reason he had these issues stemmed from insecurity. You know, when he saw new people, it made him insecure. And so that was a problem he was never going to fix on his own. He was never going to one day, like, oh, I'm secure now. Or, no, these people don't make me nervous. You know, he was never going to get there on his own. And so a dog like him needs not micromanagement, but a lot of management, a lot of telling him what to do. So, for example, in a situation like this, he will basically 100% of the time be under command. So he'll heel, he'll sit, he'll lie down, that's it. Like if she comes to a stop, she wouldn't like just hold the leash, let him sniff around. If somebody comes up and says, hey, can we pet your dog? You know, we'll either say no, depending on how he's feeling, or we're gonna manage it and say, well, let's see how he does. Why don't you just stand there and hold your hand out? But what we don't want, and this goes for Sawyer, but it also goes for any dog, what we don't want is to simply, you know, allow the dog to, allow people to come up and like get over the top of the dog's face. That causes even friendly dogs to get nervous.
Why does he walk by people? I'm watching where his focus is. So he's focused on the command. He's focused on healing, his ears are back. He's paying attention to where my leg is. If he were to fixate on somebody, I want to get him, get his focus back. So either doing a step back recall, stepping away and calling him to me, or getting a little bit of the crazy man heel method. So we can get him back into training mode.
But for those watching, also notice like the leash. A lot of folks, when they're trying to work through this, they're so worried that they keep the leash tight. They're like, oh, here comes somebody, and they tighten that leash. And in doing that, you telegraph to the dog, you're like, hey, something's wrong. And in the dog's mind, the only thing that changed was here comes another person, right? And so here comes another person, mom tightens the leash. Here comes a person, mom tightens the leash. And so the dog starts to realize people coming is a bad thing. And so, we need to communicate with the leash if necessary, but the leash needs to remain loose like 99% of the time. It's only tight for quick little taps here or there, you know, for quick little split seconds as we guide and whatnot. Hi, big guy. Yeah, so we've now passed, I don't know, a dozen people, and he's so focused on the command. He's kind of that typical border collie where he's got that slinky head, like, slinking around a little bit.
Yeah.
But he's making good choices. Let's put him in a down. So one thing that I like to do is duration work. Let's get a little distance. I'll like to kind of talk about this for a second. So duration work is this, you know, doing something for a long duration. Now, you can do something moving for a long duration, which is of course walking, which is a very good thing. But structured stillness, you know, duration and being still is super important too. And so the problem is, a lot of folks only do it at home, and it makes sense. Like, you can work on a downstay or a place command at home really easy because, I don't know, you're just, you're there. You know, you're cooking dinner, you're eating lunch, you're watching TV. I mean, you're just there, so it's easy to work on these downstays. And so what happens is a lot of these dogs, they develop a really good downstay, they develop really good duration work while you're home. But that duration work, which is very good for the mind, which is very calming, which is very soothing, often doesn't get done in public. And so to do it in public, you kind of have to just make it happen. So when I come here with clients to Lowe's or whatever, we might do this for like 5 minutes, but ideally you could do this, and you could tell doing this is a little stressful for him. He's yawning a little bit, and that's good for him to work through that stress. But yeah, doing, because just being, what are we, 20 feet away? You know, Sarah's 20 feet away or walking past, and you know, there's people walking around, makes him stressed. Duration work is good for teaching a dog to kind of work through that stress. I always kind of compare it to like a steam valve. You know, duration work is kind of that valve that lets the steam and the pressure out, whether it's duration walking or duration downstays. And so you have to contrive it, you have to make it happen. But what that means is come to Lowe's and do 5-10 minutes of a downstay. What I'll have people do when the weather's nice, or even if it's not, if they can, is go to a busy park, do a downstay 15 feet away from a bench, and you sit on the bench and read a book for 20 minutes or 30 minutes. And so, doing duration work in public can be huge, but it gets so overlooked. like I say, in the course of a month, like, I don't know, if I've got a new dog and I'm training it and it's in my house for a month, like, I probably, you know, it's so easy to have like 50 sessions of duration work indoors, but doing it out in public, like, you just have to go make it happen. It's hard, but it pays a lot of dividends. So you can see, if you see him this time, you know, his body is much more relaxed. He's not yawning. So even his second little go around with duration work, he's more comfortable and he's happier and things like that. And so that's where, like I say, when we see stress, we need to recognize it for what it is and work the dog through it. One person, buddy. So he was feeling stressed. He was yawning. He was looking around. We just said, no, just hang out and you'll be fine. And sure enough, he was, and that builds a little bit of trust.
Wait.